There is an excellent summary in the PowerPoint, but I am kind of a fan of original documents, primary documents. So we're going to look at the Fourth Amendment, the Fifth Amendment, Sixth Amendment, and the Eighth Amendment in its entirety, not a summary. So I am apologizing in advance because I'm about to read it to you. I know you can read, but I'm reading. The right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrants shall issue but upon probable cause. That's not something that was made up in movies and television shows. That's straight from the Constitution. Upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, which has been interpreted as an affidavit, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the person or things to be seized. So that is the Fourth Amendment. Now let's dive into the cases. So what the Fourth Amendment says is you cannot have the police search your house. You cannot have the police search your body. And you cannot have the police arrest you unless they have explain to someone why that needs to happen. And when I say someone, that is a magistrate, that's a judge. They have to lay out what they have seen that gives them probable cause to believe that you have committed a crime and need to be arrested, or that they're going to find something in particular on your person, or something in particular in your house or other area that's in your control. They have to swear that they are telling the truth in an affidavit, meaning that it is signed in front of a notary and delivered to the judge. And once the judge reads it and believes that there is enough there for probable cause, there's enough probable cause for them to proceed, the judge signs it, and then, and only then, can the search happen or the arrest happen. Now, we spent quite a bit of time talking about the First Amendment and the Second Amendment, and in each instance, there was an exception to the rule. That is definitely true for the Fourth Amendment. Let's talk about some exceptions. So, if the person is actually under arrest, the police or law enforcement officer does not have to go to a magistrate to get permission to search a person. So, you're already under arrest. They don't have to get an additional warrant to search you. If there is something that is in plain view, that is contraband, it's something that's obviously illegal, we call it the plain sight rule. I sometimes call it the plain smell rule as well. Then they don't have to go get a warrant. They're just going to have to put in the report that we saw crack cocaine sitting in the front seat, or whatever it is. We saw the gun with the bump stock sitting in the front seat. And if you are under arrest and they are searching you, yourself, patting you down to make sure you don't have any weapons. They also can search the area that was in your immediate control. If you could touch it or reach it, they can also search that area. That is a very small area. That's not the other room. The police can also search you if they suspect that you are committing a crime or you're about to commit a crime. Now, that one's a little tougher because that's less than probable cause. And the Fourth Amendment says you can only search someone if you have probable cause. Reasonable suspicion. So, if the police have a reasonable suspicion and and it basically shows that there is sufficient justification for stopping someone, then they can do a basic pat down, a frisk. Not the area within your control, but they can do a frisk of the person. Now, something that has been very controversial is the concept of stop and frisk. And that is the ability to stop someone because you suspect they are doing a crime and patting them down. And there are many law enforcement, most of them local law enforcement agencies, that have policies that allow them to stop someone without probable cause, but because they, in their judgment, suspect someone of doing a crime, patting them down. And the city of New York, this came up a lot in the Democratic primary. The state of New York, or New York City, had a policy where they were allowing their law enforcement officers to stop and frisk. And they were sued, and the Justice Department went back and investigated the claims of people that were complaining about their policy. And as you can suspect, disproportionately, African American males and Hispanic males in certain neighborhoods, usually those neighborhoods that were lower income, were disproportionately being stopped, disproportionately being suspected of doing something suspicious. And so the city of New York had to stop their stop and frisk program because it was being applied in a discriminatory way. But that is the only specific instance that I can give you of a ban. And that is from the Justice Department. So there, other cities are still at liberty to exercise their stop and frisk policies. A lot have stopped, but it is still out there. What about searching a person's area or home or even business without a warrant? Another exception. Because normally you have to go to the judge, give them your A, B, C, D, E, and F. This is what I saw. This rises to the level of probable cause. I need to search this house. Well, can you stop pedestrians and search for weapons or contraband without a warrant? Certainly, if there's a reasonable suspicion or if you have seen something. Another time when a search can occur without having to go through the steps to get a warrant is if the person says yes. That is called consent. It is an exception to the rule. Ooh, I y'all know I used to practice law, so I don't understand why anybody would say yes, it's fine. No, you don't have a warrant. The answer is no. Just with a smile on your face and with as much respect as possible, no, ma'am, no, sir, I do not give my consent. And turn on your TV, turn on your phone. No, I do not. You also can have a search in an area where a person cannot reasonably expect privacy. The Fourth Amendment really only protects the ability to be secure in your person, place, papers. So if it's outside, even if you put up a sign that says no trespassing, you do not have a reasonable expectation of privacy in that instance. It's called the open fields doctrine. So you got a field full of stuff you're not supposed to have, or have a shed where you are breaking down cars and you can see it from the road, or you can even see it from the sky. Then you do not have an expectation of privacy and therefore do not have Fourth Amendment protection. So I don't even know if that is an exception. It just doesn't get Fourth Amendment protection. Emergencies. If someone is in distress or your house is on fire, the police can enter your home. And don't have to go stop and go get a warrant because they need to address the emergency. If you will recall, when we were talking about the right of privacy, we were talking about the Lawrence versus Texas case. And in that instance, their neighbors, and it was a right of privacy case, or right to privacy case, their neighbors of a couple, a male couple, had called in and said that there was a robbery in process. So when the police got there, they knocked on the door, no one answered. They actually had the ability to enter the home because that was an emergency. There was a potential that someone could be inside being harmed. So they all but the thing about it is anything that they find that's out in the open or somewhere where they can address the emergency is can be used against you in a court of law. Another exception to the Fourth Amendment prohibition against unreasonable searches and seizures, and unreasonable being defined as not having a warrant. If you're in a car, and they have probable cause, so they are going to have to outline A, B, C, and D, like they would if they were going to a magistrate. But they are not. They don't have to say, "Hey, you sit here. I'm gonna go get a warrant." And you just stay here. They can't impound the car, but what they can do is go ahead and search the vehicle if they have probable cause. Not reasonable suspicion, probable cause. Our border patrol agents have a lot of leeway in pulling over and searching suspicious motorists. They don't even have to have reasonable suspicion. Just an unreasonable suspicion is enough for Border Patrol agents. Now, it says courts don't require search warrants in possible drunk driving situations, but that is actually not true anymore. Actually, there has been a case that said that that is a search, because that's what they were saying before, that it's not a search. So, it didn't have Fourth Amendment protection. But recently, the like within the last 4 years, the Supreme Court has said that that is a search, and so officers have to get a warrant before they can do a blood draw. And if you'll recall, a couple of years ago, there was the case of the police officers arrested a nurse in Utah. I don't know what city, in Utah. And the because a gentleman had been brought in, they had been chasing someone, they had hit his car, and he was unconscious. So he was at the hospital, and they suspected that he was intoxicated, and they were really kind of trying to cover their rears, to be honest. Or that at least that's what it looked like from a defense attorney's point of view. And so they were trying to draw his blood while he was unconscious. And the nurse gets her supervisor on the phone, and she's reading the hospital's policy, and she said, "Now, my understanding is that we cannot let you draw a patient's blood unless they, one, give consent to do it, two, you have a warrant to do it." And that may have been it. And so he can't give consent because he's unconscious. You don't have a warrant. So I can't let you do it. And the police officer got really angry with her and grabbed her and drug her out of the hospital. She's screaming. Her supervisor on the phone is screaming. And I mean, really, all she was doing was quoting the new Supreme Court case. Of course, the police officer got fired. The city paid her quite a bit of money. And but she was traumatized, she was upset, and she was following the new law. There is a prohibition against planting GPS on a vehicle where they used to be able to do it. There's also a prohibition against tapping phones without a wire, without a warrant. And recently, Riley versus California is, oh, I'll have to check on the year. They have now said, but it's pretty recent. They've now said that even searching a cell phone, you have to get a warrant. You have to obtain a warrant before you can look at who's been called. Or who has called the person. So you have to have a warrant, even if the person is under arrest, because you cannot explain that there's some danger that you were trying to avoid by searching their phone. So even if a person is under arrest, you still have to get a warrant to be able to search their phone. That's Riley versus California. Question about drug testing. 1989 Supreme Court ruled that it is okay to have mandatory drug and alcohol testing of employees that are involved in accidents. That is not a violation of their Fourth Amendment rights. You don't have to go get a warrant. You are able, you have a right to live in the world and not get arrested. You don't have a right to have a particular job. And so if you have a sensitive job, one that involves the security of the public, then if you are involved in an accident, next step is to go to get a blood draw, without a warrant. Schools have also been given a lot of leeway as far as drug tests are concerned. Or, oh, when I was in school, they used to have the drug dogs. the drug dogs would just go and sniff lockers, and then they would key on any locker that had drugs in it. Now again, here we go. Recently, there's been a case that has said that dogs are that's a search, so you have to get a warrant. But anytime that you have that you like require drug tests to participate in school activities, that is fine. That's fine. Intoxication checkpoints are also legal. Meaning, as long as you don't have a reasonable suspicion, so you stop that person, or you stop every black person, or you stop every woman, but you know, we're stopping every fourth car. That's fine. That's fine. And so cannot be arbitrary, but if you have a system, then it is okay to have checkpoints, and they do that a lot during the holidays. I don't know if I have this set to computer audio, so I hope that you can hear this.
7 years.
I plead the fifth.
24-hour notice event to prevent frequent heartburn.
It burns my dinner plan.
It burns a good night's sleep.
Prevacid 24-hour prevents the acid that causes heartburn.
All day, all night.
All night.
Prevacid 24-hour. Prevent the burn.
Tell us about cartels you dealt with
in your time as a crack cocaine dealer.
Defensive.
Exactly how much money did you earn
in your time as a crack cocaine dealer?
I said, there are so many amendments in the Constitution of the United States of America. I can only keep on.
Fifth Amendment is loaded. Well, first, it starts out this says and says that no person can be asked to answer for a capital crime unless there's a grand jury. That is called the grand jury clause. Grand jury clause has never been incorporated. So, first part of the Fifth Amendment is the grand jury clause. There is an exception if it arises in the land or naval forces or in the militia. Then there's no requirement for a grand jury. They have their own system. Then it goes on to say, nor shall any person be subject for the same offense to be twice put in jeopardy of life or limb. Of course, we call that the double jeopardy clause. That was what was in question in the Palco case, and eventually it was incorporated by the Warren Court in 1969, if I'm not mistaken. Nor shall be compelled in any case to be a witness against himself. Now that's what Chappelle was talking about. Cannot be compelled to be a witness against yourself. That simply means that it is not your job to help the police prove a case against you. You cannot be compelled. Their job is to gather evidence. Their job is to find probable cause. Their job is to present it to the fact finder, whether that is a judge or a jury. And their job is to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, not yours. So you cannot be compelled to give evidence if it might be detrimental to yourself. You also cannot be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. That is called the due process clause. And finally, and I, for the life of me, I cannot understand why they stuck eminent domain, which is civil, has nothing to do with rights of criminal defendants, at the end of the Fifth Amendment. But here it is. At the end of the Fifth Amendment, they say they can't take your property for public use without just compensation. Not that they can't take your property, but if they need your property to build a highway or something, then they have to pay you the market value of the property. So, I don't know why eminent domain clause is there. So that's a lot. That's a lot. The Fifth Amendment is packed. That being said, we are really only going to examine the self-incrimination part of the Fifth Amendment. And in doing so, we're going to look at the case of Miranda versus Arizona. So, March 13th, 1963, in Phoenix, I believe it was, Arizona, there was an 18-year-old girl that was kidnapped and raped. And the police started doing investigation. She wasn't really able to identify the person. She didn't know the person personally. But after some police work, the police actually arrested Ernesto Miranda. Well, they bring him in, actually, and bring the young lady in, and she identified him in a lineup. She identified him in a lineup. And so the police began to question Mr. Miranda. And what was very, very common in the United States with law enforcement officers is they would go through several several maneuvers to get a confession. Because confession was a really, really big deal. And that was usually how you, that was how you proved your case. And I'm, look, to be honest with you, we're talking about depriving you of food and water, threatening your family, threatening you, whooping you, to, you know, beating you. And anytime that you, take away someone's will by causing them harm or threatening harm, that is really a violation of the Fifth Amendment. Now, none of that happened to Mr. Miranda, though. Ernesto was interrogated for 2 hours. And Ernesto was not book smart. He had a ninth grade education. And honestly, it looked like he may have had a low IQ. But they are asking him questions, and he eventually was like, yep, I did it. And they were like, well, can you explain to us what happens? And so he explains in detail, this happened, and this happened, and this happened. I did this, and I did this, and I did this, and I did this. This gets typed up, and he signs it. Yep, it was me. I did it. And so, of course, they take Mr. Miranda to trial. And he gets convicted of the rape, of aggravated rape, based on his confession. But at this time, everybody knew that Earl Warren was up there. Earl Warren had been doing lots of cases, and we'll talk about some of those now in a minute. But so criminal defense attorneys were appealing cases and trying to get them to the Supreme Court, because the Warren Court was just knocking them down, and they were incorporating, and they did not disappoint in this case. So they appealed the case. It gets to the Supreme Court in 1966. And the court said, listen, it really does not help for people to have rights if they don't understand that they do. And when you guys talk to Mr. Miranda, and Mr. Miranda said over and over again that nobody told him he did not have to talk to the police. Nobody advised him that he could actually have an attorney in the room, and that he could decide not to talk to the police without an attorney in the room. No one explained that to him. And I mean, if you're a law enforcement officer, why the heck would you? Why the heck would you explain that to him? Well, you know, the Fifth Amendment says no, that was not going to happen until the Warren Court got a hold of it. And you know what the Warren Court decided? The Warren Court decided that when you are interrogating someone that is under arrest, you have to tell them. You have to tell them what their rights are. It is the most uncanny thing. They are called Miranda warnings. And I have not met one student, 16 to 66, that is not able to quote Miranda warnings. What are they? You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. You have the right to an attorney. If you cannot afford an attorney will be provided to you with no charge. Before police officers, to this day, before police officers can arrest someone, they have to explain what the person's, before they can interrogate them, they have to explain what their rights are. Police departments were furious, because they felt as if they were being, their hands were being tied, that they were, it was making it more difficult to complete police work because they were now having to jump through all these extra hoops. Eventually, what became very common was that the different offices would come up with these things that are called Miranda cards. If you didn't speak English, then they would get an interpreter for you. And so if a person decided that they were going to talk to the police, they would have them, they would read this to them, have the person say, yeah, I am waiting, and I want to talk to the police, and they would have a witness sign it. Now, you got a sign card saying, I understand what my rights are, and I'm waiving them, and you give a confession. They were not having to prove that they hadn't done something wrong. They were just showing the Miranda card. So in some instances, it actually made the prosecutor's job easier. But in those instances where someone said, I'm not signing it, I'm not talking to you, or I want an attorney, it made it much more difficult. Now, many people say that what this led to, I've read lots of articles. So when I say people say, I've read several articles that have explained that this was really kind of the birth of the use of forensic science in police work. Because if you are able to positively identify someone through DNA, then you don't have to get a confession. And so it made police officers and police law enforcement agencies get a lot more sophisticated in the way that they dealt with investigations. Just to tie up the Fifth Amendment in a nice little tidy bow, the Fifth Amendment does have that grand jury provision, and that is one provision that has never been incorporated. So it is fine not to have a grand jury to do indictments, and that is decide if there's enough probable cause to determine if someone has been can be charged with a crime. And some states don't use them at all. The whoever the prosecutor is just makes that decision. In some instances, you can have something that's called a, what are they called? Preliminary hearing is what they're called. And that's where the judge actually looks at the evidence and decides whether or not there's enough evidence to charge someone with the crime, whether or not there's probable cause to charge someone with the crime.